I'd like to get a little bit into the background of the financing of Bolshevism, because I think this is vitally important. And we can go back to the period after the Second Revolution, which was in October and November of 1917. The initial financing of Lenin's movement, how did it tie into the American corporations? Was there any American involvement in that period between 1917 and 1918 when Bolshevism was just beginning to get a foothold in Russia?
Yes, there were several incidents. The most important is one involving Colonel William Boyce Thompson, who was the largest shareholder in the Chase Bank, which of course today is Chase Manhattan Bank. And I published in one of my books a copy of a cablegram which transferred funds from New York to Petrograd in December 1917, $1 million to be precise. And Colonel Thompson made the statement later that this $1 million was given to the Bolsheviks to consolidate. They had just begun to take over Russia. They only controlled Moscow and Petrograd at that time to aid the control that the Bolsheviks were extending in Russia. This is a very clear case. $1 million, American funds, transferred through an American Wall Street intermediary to the Bolsheviks.
And didn't you publish that document here in Wall Street and the Rise of Bolshevism?
I published two statements. One is a copy of the cablegram, and the other is a copy of the news clip of the statement made by Colonel Thompson at that time that he had given, made this contribution.
Now, why would an American capitalist, an American financier, help to aid Bolshevism?
The only answer, and of course this puzzled me for years, you know, why? Because we understand there to be an opposition. And the only answer I can come to is one of captive markets. The United States did not want another United States in the world. And of course, if you look at the world map, Russia is two or three times larger than the United States. Imagine this as another United States, as another competitor to the United States. What the United States wanted, or Wall Street wanted, was a captive market. And of course, socialism is a captive market because my earlier studies at Stanford University had brought out the fact that a socialist system cannot innovate. It's got to import innovation and technology from the West. And so I think the aim behind this was to encourage the development of Marxism and other types of socialism, because this would give these Wall Street bankers control of a world market.
At the end of the First World War, Russia was devastated by famine, and America sent a relief mission. It was the Hoover mission. Do you know any of the facts surrounding the activities of the Hoover Commission?
Well, there's no question that in 1922, 1923, Russia was finished. Industrial output was perhaps 8 or 10% of 1913 figures, and people were starving by the hundreds of thousands. And the Hoover mission was organized, of course, to send aid to Russia. But most of the aid went to the Bolsheviks, who controlled really quite a small part of Russia at that time. Only a very small part of the aid went to the White Russians or to the Far East.
And then after 1922, 1923, Lenin instituted something known as the New Economic Policy, or this series of five-year plans. Can you tell us about the five-year plans and the part that the major American corporations, major world corporations, played in building up the Soviet Union?
Well, there are two separate phases here. The new economic policy was started in 1923 by Lenin, and I found, and I published this in my first book from Stanford, that every single Russian industry was rebuilt or restarted by foreign corporations, mostly German, British, French, and American. By 1928, Russia was back to approximately its 1913 industrial output. And at that point, she began to think of these grandiose five-year plans. And in 1928, Gosplan, which is the Russian Government Planning Commission, actually designed an initial five-year plan, but this was thrown out, it was inadequate, and American corporations were built in, were brought into Russia. And the first five-year plan and the second five-year plan were actually designed in the United States by American corporations.
And what were these corporations? Which ones specifically were involved?
The design of the first five-year plan was by a corporation probably not known to most Americans, Albert Kahn. But Albert Kahn was the foremost industrial architect in the United States. And Albert Kahn laid out the basics of the first five-year plan for the Soviets. And then we find, again, the same corporations involved with the construction of the plants. International General Electric, certainly, DuPont, Ford Motor, Hercules Motor, Curtis Wright in aircraft engines, and even some corporations which today were forgotten about, like Valti and Chance Vought. These were aircraft manufacturers at that time. And so American corporations came in and they built the first five-year plan. But what was important, the Soviets then copied these plans, and this accounts for the tremendous Russian output. They took this initial equipment and they multiplied it, they copied it by the hundred.
Now, how about Ford Motor Company? Did they play a part in the building up of the Soviet potential?
Very definitely. Ford Motor Company built the Gorky plant, and the Gorky plant produces the GAZ series of vehicles, that's GAZ, and these are trucks, and there's some automobiles. And right from the early 1930s, you find that the GAZ plant has had military potential, and Ford knew that when it went in and built the Gorky plant. And we know it because I found statements to this effect within the State Department files.
Sometimes we hear the name Averill Harriman. Did he play a part in building up the Soviet technology?
Very definitely. In fact, Averill Harriman came out of the Soviet Union financially at a profit. He took over the Georgian manganese concession in the early 1920s. Got this back on his feet for the Soviets, and manganese became a prime export for the Soviets, and so they were able to sell this abroad, get foreign exchange, which financed their industrialization. And then they bought out Harriman about 1929, and Averill Harriman received as compensation $1 million more than he put in the first place.
How about Armand Hammer of Occidental Petroleum?
Armand Hammer is a very interesting example. Armand Hammer received the first foreign concession in 1922 in asbestos in the Ural Mountains. And he also conducted for the Soviets a number of other enterprises, right down to pens and pencil manufacturing, for example. But Armand Hammer is interesting because his father, although Armand Hammer today is chairman of Occidental Petroleum Corporation, his father was Julius Hammer, who in 1919 was Secretary General of the Communist Party USA, which emphasizes the argument I made throughout my books, that at the top level, there's no difference between your top communist and your top capitalist, the interlink. You've got Armand Hammer, chairman of Occidental Petroleum. His father was secretary of the Communist Party USA in 1919.
So it's basically a power grab.
It's a power grab, an international power grab.
Now, during the Second World War, why Russia was pretty well decimated once again by German forces, what part did the American Unleashed program play in building up Russia's industrial capacity after the Second World War?
Well, Lend-Lease built up Russia's capacity, modernized it and expanded it during World War II. And there was some continuation all the way through perhaps to 1948-1949. There was a program after Lend-Lease which was supposed to be restricted to foodstuffs and industrial materials, but in effect, I checked the records in the warehouses in Sutton, Maryland, I find that even after World War II, and this was against the intent of Congress, I suspect, there was a massive transfer of the latest industrial equipment to the Soviet Union under the so-called Lend-Lease program.